who need be voiced. Your mind speaks to us.
Welcome everyone to Kiss Misa Podcast 4K, the crazy, crazy Kiss cough down. I am one of your hosts, Eli Clausen.
And I am Luke Neely, appropriately sitting in my padded room for this episode.
He's in his own asylum.
Yeah.
We're back, had a week off, a little bit of a family emergency, spent the whole day with my mom in a hospital in Columbus last week. Everything went great, so no worries with that. So that's why we were gone for the week. Gave everyone extra time to completely just throw a big wrench in everything because we had some major changes come. Luke was messaging me the other day. He said he finally tallied up all the different votes we've been getting in on all the albums. There's been tons of changes and whatnot. And then even for this episode alone, which by the way is Asylum, a lot of input on it. So loving it. Here in a few minutes, you know, we'll get into the, you know, updates. I'm sure there's probably too much to go through every single one, but maybe just kind of point out maybe some of the bigger things that took place. And also with the actual input on Asylum, there were so many, so we figured we don't want to waste your time just sitting here reading through so many of them. So it'll be posted on the screen for you guys to check out and go from there. But today is a special day as we're recording this on the 19th, the release of Spaceman, Ace Frehley's new album. I thought it was already out. I was running around yesterday looking for it, and come to find out it came out today. So this, of course, I haven't listened to it yet. I just got back home with it, you know, maybe a couple hours ago, and looking forward to it. It's, you know, pretty nice packaging, you know, pulling out the inner sleeve. Kind of reminds me of the solo album inner sleeve in a way with those four, you know, shots there. And then you got the shot on the back with some liner notes.
Nice.
Yeah, pretty interesting. Of course, as we know, Gene Simmons co-wrote a few of the songs on here with him. He also plays bass on the opening track, Without You I'm Nothing. Anton Figgs on drums for a couple songs.
Awesome.
A pretty cool variety of people on here. Scott Coogan, you know, is on drums for some of the songs, but there are other drummers as well. So, a big mix. And this particular edition is on the really nice silver vinyl.
Ooh.
Apparently there is a violet version also, and it actually has a different picture on the cover. The one with the violet is the one where he's sitting with his legs crossed, so this one's a different photo for the silver, and I'm pretty sure there's just a standard black version as well. And then there was also a indie record exclusive that had a completely different cover. It was like multiple shots of him just kind of standing there with his guitar with a white background, and it came on an orange vinyl. From what I understand, they only pressed like 1,000 of those, and those of course have already pretty much flown off the shelves. I've already seen some on eBay going for outrageous prices now, so there you go. But of course it does come with the download card, which I never use those, so maybe if you want it, I'll give it to you here at the end of the show.
I saw earlier Mike Brunn posted about the release of that album. Did you see that post?
I did not.
He said this is actually, believe it or not, the first time ever that there's been a song that's been written by only Gene and Ace.
Wow.
First time ever. How weird is that?
That's a cool little tidbit, yeah. And, you know, I'm sure everyone and their mother knows this album in and out by now, because I know a lot of the other podcasts have already done their reviews on the album, and, you know, I've heard a lot of good things about it, which, you know, is kind of to be expected in a way. I mean, coming off of Origins, that was a cool album, and then I was hoping that this one would follow right up with it, and it sounds like it has, so I can't wait to throw it on and give it a few listens. So, with that out of the way, let's see. I guess we'll just kind of start getting into things. I know we have probably a hodgepodge of comments again and whatever else is maybe to catch up with.
Real quick, I just suddenly realized, when you said something about giving me that download code, what did I respond?
I don't even know. You probably just went, ugh. Farted.
I don't know why, but really sort of... I don't know. I'm not sure what I said. Okay. That's the kind of day I've been having today, is like, what, say something, and then I turn around, I'm like, what did I just say?
We'll have an instant replay. Slow-mo. I guess I'm having that day, too, because I don't even remember what you said, either. So.
Just happened. Yeah.
Of course, I don't usually listen to what you say anyway, so.
That's funny.
Get off my lawn.
Yeah.
So, man, so while you're kind of getting things ready, man, Asylum. So, I got to say, it's my least favorite as far as, you know, the look and the costumes. Huh. But, you know, I'll tell you what, this album has grown on me. I think I kind of touched on this at the end of the last episode. I gave this album a proper listen again, you know, a couple years ago, and I was like, man, this is a lot better than what, you know, credit I was giving, because, again, I was kind of doing the whole judging the book by its cover. I was thinking, oh, you know, the look has to go with the sound, you know, other than the hits that are on there, and, man, was I surprised. Like, you know, this album is pretty heavy, I mean, for its time. I mean, and, you know, for my money's worth, in my opinion, the look does not match the sound at all.
That, I would say that look would come closer to matching Crazy Nights than this.
Absolutely.
You know?
I mean, some of the stuff on here, you know, Gene still sounds reminiscent of Creatures at times, but then there is one song where he sounds like he's already on that way towards Crazy Nights, where it's a little softer and whatnot, but yeah, you know, again, Gene doesn't have, you know, the greatest songs on here, but he also, of course, didn't have the input either, so it's
to be expected,
definitely another dominated, you know, Paul album, I guess.
Right.
So we'll see, but I'm sure that's how it'll turn out.
Right. Oh, hey, speaking of that, our tiebreaker for Animalize.
Oh, God, yeah. We completely, yeah.
We're so unused to having to start the episode with that. So, interestingly, because we had so many votes, and I wasn't able to get to them all at once, so I did a bunch of them as they came in. It decided the tie. We had it in there. It's the one that I sent you last night. Then today, I've seen a few more votes that I've retallied, and it actually changed it again.
Wow.
Yeah, that's, again, with the morphing, you never know what's going to be where. So I'm fairly certain that the most of the, you know, 10 through 4 is the same as was read at the end of the last episode. But our top three for Animalize, in third place, Thrills in the Night. Second place, I've Had Enough, Into the Fire. And in first place, Heaven's on Fire. And then we got 7.4 out of 10 overall.
Pretty good. That's kind of what I figured the top three would end up being.
Yeah. So. Yep.
And thank you guys again for all the input to help us get that tiebreaker, because, you know, that was definitely a tough decision. So.
Yeah.
It definitely helps having you guys with all the input, and, you know, this one, it just, I feel like we get more and more every week, because with everything we have for this episode, it's just, I mean, like I say, we had so much that we don't want to sit here and waste your time reading it. We're going to have to just show an image now, so that's kind of where we're getting.
Yeah, we finally reached that level where we're getting mind-blowing. I don't remember, I think it was before the Lick It Up episode when I got on to, you know, I go through each episode every week to see if there's new comments and things, and to see all of those votes, my mind was blown. Like, holy crap, we're catching it. So, yeah, definitely thank you guys.
And still took notes on, you know, any matches on the song, so we will still mention those, and, you know, as you're looking at the image on the screen, too, to get an idea what everyone else ranked everything.
Indeed. And I'll, we're going to start posting the game board on our social sites as well, so you can go check out what all changed there, because there is a few interesting ones we'll point out once we get there, but...
Yeah, for that matter, we might as well post that voting image, too, just for the heck of it.
Absolutely. So, first off, clear back to the first episode, we've got a bunch more votes.
Wow.
So, We won't go through all of that, but big thank you to Jay Rucker, your whole family. I mean, this has almost become the Rucker show now.
That is awesome.
Man, yeah. So thank you for all of those. Thank them, of course, for all of that. And just throwing this out there, too, it's completely up to them if they want to keep doing it the way they've been doing it. But we really don't have a good system to tally in partial lists. So if they do happen to get free enough moments to get the full ranking albums, we could get that in there a little better. But loving the input anyway. We've included all of their overall rankings no matter what. So that's all in there. Also, GG Aaron, I saw he popped up on just about all of them, your vote. So thank you so much for that. We got that in there. And I got to ask, whenever you get on here to do your next one, what is it about Kissin' Time that made it your number one for the first album?
Luke's been having conniptions about that, trust me.
It shook me so bad I had to text him. Like, what is going on? So, legitimately, again, we've said it a million times, that's part of the great fun of doing this is seeing differing opinions like that, but I'm genuinely curious because I'm pretty sure that one was bottom of both of our lists.
Yeah, I mean,
what is it you like about that one?
And I'm pretty sure Aaron is the same Aaron I'm thinking of. That's he's in Australia. So is that another one of those cases where, you know, those kind of songs are huge over there for whatever reason? I don't know. Let us know, man.
Absolutely. Okay, so let's fast forward in time here to the Lick It Up episode, where we have a ton of comments here. First one is from Robbie Stars, and he says, Lick It Up is a good rockin' album, but it took me a long time to like most of it. After hearing Creatures, how good that was, I had high hopes for this album. Well, Kiss decided to take off the makeup, then add Vinnie Vincent full-time, and then seeing the Lick It Up video was a pure letdown. They release a song with no guitar solo? Yeah. I hadn't thought of that, but yeah.
I gotta say, though, at this point, I'd almost prefer that without the guitar solo than adding in the Who guitar solo.
Yeah.
Like they do it now. It's like, like we said, yeah, we talked about that. It's just, I'm kind of past that, man.
Right. I think I may have mentioned in the last episode, too, that Heaven's on Fire was the same way. I mean, it had a solo, but it was almost nothing. So you've got two guitarists since Ace who can both just blaze up and down a fretboard like nobody's business, but the hit songs, no solo.
Yeah. What? You know, it's kind of like Eric's first album. It's like he got held back and wasn't able to show what he can do, and that's kind of what happened with those songs, with those guitar players.
Right. So he says, yes, Kiss changing things up, and I had to learn to accept all of this. Well, my uncle got me this tape through Columbia House for Christmas with other tapes and the likes of Quiet Riot, Scorpions, and Loverboy, and a few others, and I couldn't get into Lick It Up. Exciter by far was the best track, and still is, and Not for the Innocent sounded like a Creatures tune, which actually was cut from that album and saved for this one. On side two, I ignored all three Gene tunes and listened to just All Hell's Breaking Loose and A Million to One, but as years went by, I went back to this on CD and liked the entire thing somewhat. It's like you two said, it's a sister album to Creatures, but not as good. Vinny's style is different, but most of the songs work, especially Fits Like a Glove. At its release, I would have given it a 4 rating, but years later, played this more, and it holds up well today, so I'll give it an 8. I actually prefer Animalize over this album. Also, one question for you. Can you open up one of your countdown episodes playing a favorite Kiss tune on your guitar and drums? That would be totally awesome. We totally should. That would be interesting.
You know,
get on that.
There's a few ways we can go about that.
Yeah.
Because we have those old recordings that you and I did of just guitar and drums, and then there's video clips or you just doing it live.
Mm. Yes, interesting. Interesting thoughts there.
Yes.
The wheels are a-turning. All right, so let's see. What else do we have? Oh, okay, we've got a comment from Jay Rucker here, who has given us a whole list of other things we should rate. such as best costumes, worst to best album covers, worst to best albums, worst to best member, musically, not personally, top 25 Kiss songs, top 5 stages, top 10 songs from the 4 originals because the others don't have enough, top 5 worst songs. Yeah.
Okay.
It's all on the list.
Add it all to the menu.
Yes. See, again, Jay, man, this was going to just be the kind of like the core discography, and then we were going to move on to something else. But no, you've given us all these ideas that the 4K is going to last forever now.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Definitely awesome. Also, several other little comments here from Jay, most of which were his family's ratings. He did note that regarding Animalize, he bought his niece a copy of the 20th Century Remastered DVD, and we watch it together every once in a while. The first video she always goes to is Heaven's on Fire. So, nice. He also says, I think Vinnie Vincent saved Kiss as a rock band, but I don't know because the stuff on Killers is pretty heavy and rockin'. Very true.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's see. We got a Javier Boster comment here. He says, the news that Kiss was taking off the makeup was a big deal back then. To me, it was very exciting. I had already dealt with 2 original members leaving, so knowing that they were no longer going to wear the makeup was not devastating to me. So that night as I watched the big reveal on MTV, I couldn't help but think that even though a huge part of my childhood was coming to an end, that my teen years were going to carry on with a new era that I was completely 100% supportive of. I really liked the new song and video that premiered after the unveiling, but truth be told, I'm kind of sick of hearing Lick It Up. Anyway, within days I had the new LP. As with Creatures of the Night, I was completely blown away. There are even times that I feel that it's better than Creatures. The 80s metal movement was just starting to take off at the time, and I felt that with Vinny on lead guitar, no band could compare. This is by far the best non-makeup LP, and if it were not for the classic LPs that the original band released, it very well could have been my favorite. So after the release of Creatures of the Night and Lick It Up, it was at this time that I went back to give Dynasty and Unmasked another chance, and I soon realized that these were far better LPs than I had originally thought, and my love for them had begun again.
By the way, Javier, I have to apologize because with all the nonsense with the new job and then with the family stuff, I've totally have not had a chance yet to message you and get all that set up, but I promise, you know, things are kind of getting back into place, so we'll definitely get in touch, and would definitely still love to have you on anytime. So just want to throw that out there.
Definitely. I've got another comment from Robbie down here. Most of this is his ratings for Lick It Up, where he refers to Gimme More as Lick My Candy Cane. He remarks the live version of Lick It Up is killer. Let's see. On Exciter, which by the way is his number one, he says Derringer's solo is perfect. Go on YouTube and listen live with Vinny. It's way too much, but for a Vinny solo song, it fits right on his first album.
Now I want to know the live version of Lick It Up. Are you saying the way they do it now, or the way they did it in the 80s, or you know which version of the live are you referring to, or maybe all of them?
Right. Yeah, I've always enjoyed the live version of that one, as far as like say Alive 3 or even Rock the Nation. But yeah, no, I agree that the Who thing is getting old for sure. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's all for the Lick It Up episode. So we can come up to last week's episode, Animalize, which has a ton of comments. Again, mind blown. First couple here are from Jay, and he says, a cool thing I think you could do is the Kiss members' solo albums in order, like not a member's albums in order, but something like the order they came out in, and then he listed all of them. So, yeah, agree. We were actually talking about that, I think, maybe last week.
Oh, yeah, you mean like the stuff after Kiss that they all did, like Peter and Ace and all that. Right. Oh, yeah, yeah, absolutely.
And he did also provide us with a handy list in order, so
nice.
There we go. Yes. He also wanted to apologize to you for including Gene's second album on there.
I might forgive you.
Yes.
Which, by the way, I also found the Ace 12 Picks CD while I was out and about. And I was actually looking for some of the Peter albums, but no luck.
Yeah. No, I agree with you there, JF. We were actually talking about doing that once the core albums are done. I mean, why not, you know?
Yeah, so I'm thinking, like, the box set would probably be maybe the, I don't know, maybe we could do that last instead of, you know, before all the other, and then go into that or something. Yeah, we'll figure it out once we get there, but, and then after that, with all these other ideas for different rankings, it's going to be fun. And we want all your guys' input for those just as well.
Absolutely.
When we get to that.
Yep. All right, so another Jay comment here, his ratings for Animal Eyes. He did give this one an 8.5 out of 10, and he notes, the first time I heard this album, my dad used to play this CD a lot in his car, and I loved Under the Gun, and I still do, but Gene sucks on this album.
Yeah.
He says, I know I said on Creatures episode that Creatures was the Last Kiss 8-track, but I went on Discogs, and Animal Eyes is the Last Kiss 8-track. So, nice.
Wow, okay.
Yeah. We also have his Asylum votes here. He says he thinks this is the second best non-makeup album, in my opinion. Sorry, Kiss Army. I'm right there with you, man. No apologies there. he said some cool facts. The highest charting position, it charted at number 1 in Finland.
Wow.
The Tears Are Falling single got to number 20 on the mainstream rock charts and number 57 on the Hot 100. So. Nice. I'm surprised that didn't get a little higher than that. Let's see. Okay, here's Robbie Starrs. He says, when Asylum came out, I wasn't a big fan of it, and one reason was the horrible album cover. I was like, how did this band turn into something cool, and having a hot album like Animal Eyes to Let's Wear Pink and Gene looking like Leolo from Mama's Family?
Or B. Arthur.
Also, when I heard All Night, my days of being a Kiss fan were over with for now. Still to this day, I do not own this CD. The only Kiss CD I don't have. Maybe I'll get a copy of it one of these days. There are a few killer tracks on Asylum, but nothing really grabbed me at all. These songs definitely are a step down than what was on Animal Eyes, but Mr. Kulik sounds awesome on it. I give this album a 6.5. Some of Paul's songs are bad, and the only Gene song that's good is Secretly Cruel. I personally hate Trial by Fire because Eric's not on it. It's a drum machine. What's up with that? I didn't know that.
Huh.
Carr's drumming is great on the songs. He's on, but like I said, I'm no fan of this album.
You know, I got to agree with All Night. I mean, we were kind of talking about this before we started. I mean, I've always been kind of love-hate with that song. Like, sometimes I find it kind of boring, and, you know, especially the video, and then other times it's like, I like listening to it, so I don't know, it's just one of them, it's always been like that with me all through these years.
Yeah, I've never had a problem with it. I've never thought it was a great song or anything, but I've always liked it.
Yeah.
I think it's hilarious, really, more than else, yeah. another comment here. Actually, I think there's two more comments from Robbie. He says, by the way, a fun and hilarious episode, guys. Luke's right, the guitar riffs are killer and were nothing like Kiss had before this album. Makes it very memorable, in my opinion. That's what makes this album so unique. After listening to Animal Eyes all week, I'm changing my rating to a 10. I love it that much.
Wow.
Nice. He also says, the difference between Lick It Up and Animal Eyes is the production and the crazy riffs and changes on most of the Animal Eyes tunes. The songwriting is on another level compared to Creatures and Lick It Up. From a musician's point of view, it's definitely fun to play, and also a challenge. Lick It Up is raw in your face, and Animal Eyes is high-energy heavy metal produced with St. John's and Kulik's wicked guitar solos. I agree with Luke. I like Animal Eyes more. I love Animal Eyes. My favorite Kiss Unmasked album, or my favorite Unmasked Kiss album. The songwriting is strong, and you can tell Kiss limited Vinny's guitar solos compared to St. John's.
Hmm. You know, I gotta say, though, all those, you know, non-makeup albums, you can definitely hear, you know, the evolution album by album. You know, their sound just evolves. Not that they, you know, change to go with what's popular, it's like you could just kind of hear that change and kind of where they were heading. And, you know, that's one thing I love about that era, too, is everything doesn't sound the same, thankfully.
Right.
I'm not saying everything in the 70s sounded the same, because obviously it didn't either, but just to clarify.
Definitely. Let's see. We got a comment from Chief Broken Arrow, which included a rating for Animalize, so we got that in there, man. Thank you. He says, I bought this album the day it came out, like I did with a lot of Kiss albums. I liked it. I played it over and over in my Sony Walkman while I was at work. I thought it was a natural progression from Lick It Up, which is one of my favorite Kiss albums. And what a heck of a concert tour this was. I saw it with Queensryche opening up. Mm. It wasn't until nowadays that I found out how many Kiss fans really dump on this album. I think it's a good 80s Kiss album. Not great, but good. Keep up the good work, guys.
Thank you. And I've honestly never really heard anyone say anything bad about Animalize.
Yeah, again, kind of the same as what he was saying. Only recently have I found out that there were people that didn't like it too much, and I was surprised.
Because usually it's just, you know, Crazy Nights, Hot in the Shade is kind of the ones I hear the most flack about as far as, you know, like the 80s stuff goes. Well, yeah. I guess you could say Elder and Unmasked for that matter.
But. Right. Right. Ooh, I forgot. Back when Jay gave us his Animalize ratings, by the way, he did put "Burn Carnival of Souls" burn. So that was pretty funny. Nice, but I do like that album. I don't.
Yeah, it's another one that's growing on me too. It's another one where I only listened to like two songs at first, and now I'm like, oh, this just about this whole album's pretty good.
Yeah, I've always liked it. Okay, so comments, a couple here from Rock McDowell, and he says, just my opinion, but this album started the straight-to-video approach. Visual sounds good, but if you listen to the CD, it lackluster. Not bad, but to me, Heavens, Thrills, Tears Are Falling, all the way to Revenge was wrote with video in mind, but I'll listen to it again and again. Thumbs up, guys. He also says, as I remember, Mark played a lot of stuff he couldn't duplicate later. The White Tiger LP came out later. If I remember right, he had no previous experience and was basically teaching, which is weird then that he couldn't repeat his licks in the studio. That is weird.
Right, but at the same time, you know, we got to remember this was the height of MTV. I mean, everyone was coming up with these off-the-wall, you know, mini films of music videos. I mean, look at Michael Jackson, and, you know, there was just tons of stuff that was. And in some cases, that's what made the song popular was the video. If it wasn't for that video that might be legendary, the song itself may have just kind of gotten ignored.
Right.
And, you know, back when they had the whole MTV Music Awards, you know, the video music, it really meant something back then. Like, who had, you know, the best, you know, video as far as the production and all the special effects they put in and whatever. But, you know, it completely has no meaning nowadays, but, you know, at that time, I remember it felt like a big deal, and, you know, the Cars had so many cool music videos, and Tom Petty had so many great ones, and, you know, ZZ Top, like, there were so many, you know, Van Halen, so many bands were, Quiet Riot, were coming up with so many creative music videos that they were fun to watch. And yeah, they're still fun to watch to this day, and that, you know, that's why they're so classic. And not the stuff off of Asylum isn't necessarily classics, but yeah, they were going for that look. And, you know, who could forget Bruce in the waterfall doing his solo? And and I feel like it wasn't long after this is when Poison came on the scene. Because then they sort of almost had the same type of look at first. And, you know, there was a lot of the neon colors going on and, you know, the big hair and all that stuff. So,
right.
I mean, that, you know, that's one thing we got to remember. Like, everyone was, like, gearing up. Like, if you didn't have a good music video, you weren't successful pretty much at that time.
Right. Yep. I think it depends on a lot of different things. Because I never personally thought that listening to the songs. I've never thought that, geez, these songs sound like a cop-out or a phone-in, except for maybe some of Gene's.
Right.
But, you know, I don't know. Maybe I've just got a weird perspective on it because I kind of liked that style of music anyway. know? Yeah.
And, you know, as bad as the look is, I mean, you know, yeah, there's some cool parts in all those videos, and but I feel like they don't help the song any. I feel like the songs are, you know, strong enough on their own.
Right. Right. All right, we also have another comment here, and apologies, man, if I destroy your name, because I'm terrible with this sort of thing. Gianni Ottaviani, I think. And he says, always listening to you every time you have a new episode. You're great. A big hello from Italy.
Wow.
Yes.
Hello, Italy. Thank you very much for the words. That's kind of mind-blowing, man.
Yeah, exactly. As if it weren't cool enough that we get all these comments, to know there's people listening in other countries like you, man, that you appreciate it, clear from over there. That's awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, here we are, just two normal guys that, you know, KISS fans, and here we are sitting in our houses in Ohio, you know, in random areas, and, you know, the fact that you appreciate what we do, I mean, you don't know how much that means, man, so that says a lot. Thank you. Matter of fact, it goes for everyone. I don't mean to just, but, you know, the fact that he's in Italy, but the fact that anyone finds what we do interesting and entertaining and whatever the case, hey, thank you so much. It's, you know, more than flattering. So
that is true. So I think it's time for some album info.
Uh-oh.
Hmm. So, Asylum, the 13th studio album. The first with officially Bruce Kulick as the lead guitarist, replacing Mark St. John, of course. Let's see. And this actually starts the other kind of big lineup of KISS, you know, Paul, Gene, Eric Carr, and Bruce, which lasted until, unfortunately, Eric Carr died. Spoiler alert, by the way. But
we ruined the show now.
Yeah. I would say there's arguably three sort of main KISS lineups, and of course it's the original lineup, this lineup, and then the lineup they have now, which has lasted longer than any other lineup.
Right.
But yeah, this is the other kind of like the main unmasked lineup, I think I would say.
I have to say one little tidbit. I'm not sure if you already knew this, but I just recently was reading that Animalize Live Uncensored, because I found out it too has overdubs, but that film, that is actually Bruce's first night as the full-time guitar player.
Really?
Yes.
I didn't know that. That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder when he found out. Like, were they getting ready to go on stage and Paul's like, by the way, you're sticking around.
Or maybe Mark came walking up like, guys, sorry. That was messed up. No, you know what I mean. But, yeah, I mean, and like I said before, it's like, how'd they have time to even get him prepped and work with him or whatever? It just says a lot. Like,
yeah.
And I don't know if Bruce has ever went into those kind of details, but now I'd kind of like to know that. So.
Right.
I'll probably forget come next expo if he's there again. I'll forget again.
Yep. Happens that way. They're always like, would you like to ask a question? And I'm like, no. No clue. A million questions at every moment except this one. So this album was released on September 16th, 1985, because of course it was released around September at that time. All of them were, it seems like.
Asylum. The new KISS album, Accept No Imitations. On Mercury Records and Tapes, KISS Asylum. You'll be crazy about it.
Available at all Tape World and Record Town locations for $6.99.
Recorded from June to July of 1985. Man, 2 months for this. Electric Lady Studios in New York, and also Right Track Studios. So back at Electric Lady. Seems like it's been a minute. Produced by Paul. And Gene's listed too, but let's be real. It's Paul.
Right, right.
Just Tears Are Falling as far as singles go. This one is noted for its tour, of course, with the crazy costumes, colorful, crazy costumes. Also, this is one of the only non-makeup callbacks to the makeup as far as the cover goes, with their lips all being the colors, even Bruce's being blue and Eric's being green, which is kind of interesting. Calling back to the solo album covers there. This tour is notable for having the largest KISS logo the band has ever used, even to this date, one of the largest lighting rigs, and there's almost no concert footage of this tour.
Right.
Which sucks.
Just a few, you know, fan shot bootlegs that are out there floating around, but unfortunately not the greatest quality, but...
Yeah. Not a whole lot of stuff played live from this album, except, of course, Tears Are Falling, which even that's kind of, sometimes they do and sometimes they don't.
And, I don't know, like, in my opinion, All Night and Who Wants to Be Lonely, to me, those are singles because they made videos for them.
Right.
And I'm pretty sure MTV's aired them, you know, from time to time. I don't know what that technicality is there, but...
Right.
I've always considered those to be the singles as well.
I don't know why they would, at least Who Wants to Be Lonely, which personally I would argue is a better song than Tears Are Falling anyway. I don't know why they wouldn't release that as a single.
You know, talk about mind-blowing. I've seen a list that listed, like, say, the top 100 KISS songs, and they listed Who Wants to Be Lonely as the number one song. And that totally blew my mind, but I'm like, it's a good song, but... I personally don't see it anywhere in the top 10, let alone number one, but...
That is interesting. All right, so down to personnel here. Of course, we've got Paul, rhythm guitar and vocals. Also says he played bass on Tears Are Falling, which I didn't know.
Hmm.
Gene just lists bass and vocals. Eric, drums, percussion, backing vocals. Bruce, lead guitar, backing vocals. We've also got Gene Bouvier, who played bass... and did backing vocals on Who Wants to Be Lonely and All Night. So sorry, Gene, you didn't play on any of the important ones from this album. And it again lists Alan Schwartzberg for additional drum overdubs.
Or is that Gene's alter ego for when he was wearing all that makeup and the costume? Gene Bouvier.
Yeah, that's what it is. This album has only been certified gold. Okay, it looks like 20 is the peak position on the U.S. charts, too, which honestly is a little higher than I expected, considering some of the bigger 70s albums were really low.
Yeah, not bad, really.
Yeah.
Yeah?
First, we've got to hit the United States. We haven't been there in a while. We just met, but don't make much of this.
That's right. We're going to be on a wedding cake together. This
Go back to Asylum. Now, you it's self-produced. You two produced it, as yeah. as you did Animalize.
Right. Yeah.
What? Why aren't you sort of tempted to use these big-name producers like
Lonely Hearts? We are big-name producers.
Apart from...
Well, you got to figure that it's kind of like management. We don't have management because yeah. anything at this point would be mismanagement. Yeah. You know, nobody can understand what we're all about better than us. So to have some guy come in... and basically try to interpret what we're doing means that they would dilute and distort what we're doing.
Yeah.
I mean, whatever we do, and we're just going to keep doing it. If people like it, they can go out and listen and buy it and whatever. We otherwise...
And you do it well.
That's what we've been told. That's what you told me before the show.
I did.
She said I did it well.
Now, keep the secrets quiet. Are you sex symbols now?
I don't know. You know, I kind of see KISS concerts are basically like window shopping. You know, the girls show up at the shows and they look at the merchandise and then they come back to the hotels and claim it. You know, it's kind of like Christmas every day when KISS is in town.
It's either that or they've got to come back to the hotel and claim their underwear. There's a lot of it that flies up on the stage. Not from the guys.
I think you're sex symbols.
All right. I think we've got all of that taken care of, so we can jump over to Steve and my dad's stuff here. So Steve's got some stuff besides his rankings. Of course, you can see Steve's rankings on the little picture that we've posted. His notes here, he says, by far my least favorite KISS album of all time. Wow. That's heavy. Heavy. I dislike this era and the look for KISS. It was said that Gene was thinking about leaving KISS to become a Hollywood star. I think Gene carried over his Velvet Von Ragnar character from Never... Too Young to Die movie into the band. Also, everybody, pop over to our Facebook page and check out the posting of the Animalized video, which is where this comment is, and you'll see Steve included a comparison picture with his comment. It's pretty hilarious, too.
I want to see Steve dress as that character.
Yes. He says, Gene's writing was obviously so pathetic on this album, in my opinion. Very disappointed. Like a true Kiss fan, I stuck by them, though. Bruce Kulick's guitar solos are amazing. That's a plus side, and of course, Paul didn't disappoint with his list of songs on this album. I saw this tour, and even to me, the stage setup was just okay. Nothing really to brag about. And he only ranked this album 2 out of 10.
Jeez. Well, don't leave Eric Carr out. He has some nice performances on here, too, so...
I almost forgot, there is one of the early album comments that we got as far as things that changed our game board that I do want to go ahead and mention. Jay Rucker's dad gave The Elder the lowest ranking that anybody has given any of the albums so far in this series. With a pathetic 0.5 out of 10.
Wow. Tell us how you really feel.
So there's definitely that. also here on our Facebook page, we've got Jason Vanover, who commented, Asylum to me is the best of the non-makeup era to me. He gave it the album a 9 out of 10 and also gave his rankings, which are included in that picture. So this is definitely a mixed bag of opinions just already. And we haven't even started talking about our...
This album's going to start some fights.
So it looks like I've just got Dad's rankings here. He did a 6 out of 10. His actual rankings will be on the picture with everybody else's. Looks like he didn't include any notes for this one, so I think we are good to go.
Okay. All right, starting at number 10, I match your dad, Steve, and Magenica with Any Way You Slice It. Just a god-awful Gene song. The only tad bit of goodness I can give it is the way he sings. It kind of still has that, that Gene Creatures type of, to it. But other than that, just a horrible song, I think. And to follow up King of the Mountain, that was a bad choice.
Yeah, that was, there are definitely stronger Gene songs, even just on this album.
Yes, yes.
That should have come right after King of the Mountain, yeah. Yeah, and I wonder, too, because I don't remember which song it is, but I feel like it's Burn Any Way You Slice It Burn, Animalized. I think he says Any Way You Slice It in the lyrics, which is interesting, so I wonder if that's where he got the idea for this song title.
He was really reaching.
He was. Gee, yeah, he was. My number 10 here, Love's a Deadly Weapon. Which again, it just falls to me into that horrible Gene song, just non-memorable. I don't mind the riff. I'll say this: I like the upbeat, and Eric Carr, of course, is just kicking on that song.
Yes.
Overall, meh.
Yeah. My number 9 is also "Love's a Deadly Weapon," also matching Steve, Sam, and Magenica, and. Yeah, right, again, two Gene songs leading off the top of my list, just horrible written in, quality of songs, and, it's kind of like the way people looked at The Elder and stuff, except for me, it's like, okay, you got Creatures, which to me is like, damn near the Sgt. Pepper of Kiss, and then he goes to this kind of stuff. It's like, come on, Gene.
Even if you focused your efforts elsewhere, surely you can come up with something better.
Right, right.
Something better than that.
Right. Yeah.
Strangely, my number 9 is Any Way You Slice It, so we've basically got the same bottom of the list. So. Yeah, there's really nothing else to say about that one. That's just... I do feel like Bruce did a fairly decent job of trying to save both of those, because, you know, maybe if you took the lyrics out and gave both songs better lyrics, they would have been totally fine. But, eh.
Well, in my opinion, because I know you think differently, I don't think there's anything bad that Bruce has ever done, like, in the whole time that he was with Kiss.
Right.
I mean, that's really probably some of the best things you could say about those songs is, yeah, what Bruce is doing on there.
Without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Number 8 is All Night. Again, kind of love-hate with this song. When I hear it, I go, and then it's just, I don't know. I just find it kind of boring. It's a little A-B-A-B-E, nothing real too catchy out there. You know, something about the chorus, too, just that, how high Paul's doing that one voice in the chorus just is always kind of like, I don't know. I just don't, I've never been a fan of the way it sounded for some reason. It's just like, and I'm talking ever since the first time I watched Exposed and saw that video, it's just like, it immediately just always kind of rubbed me wrong. Even to this day, if I watch that video. So number 8. Yep.
My number 8, Radar for Love. This one to me feels like Paul's attempt at phoning in a Gene Simmons song. still better than some of the Gene songs, clearly. But yeah, I don't know. This one just never struck me. I remember hearing it when I had this album on and feeling like, oh, geez, another Gene song, until Paul started singing, and I was like, oh.
Right, because the title, for some reason, it does make you think, oh, okay, it's a Gene song.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, just not a very good thing to write about. I feel like Paul's usually better about coming up with good things to write about, and this, even the concept of the lyrics was kind of dumb to me.
It's almost like it was going to be a Gene song, and then he couldn't show up to do the vocals, so Paul's like, ah, oh, I'll sing it.
Yeah.
All right, number 7 is Trial by Fire. Yeah, pretty cool song. It's, you know, definitely not the strongest on the album by any means, of course, but, you know, it's not bad. I mean, again, you know, Bruce, he definitely puts a lot in this song. And really, that's, you know, about it, to be honest. Definitely not one of the songs I go to that often on this record. So,
my number 7, and honestly, even just looking at it, I'm questioning a little bit why I put this one so low. Secretly Cruel. One of the better Gene songs on this album, I would say. Almost reminiscent of 70s Kiss, even. The guitar riff is similar to Mr. Speed. Yeah. And, yeah, I've always liked the song. There actually is somewhere on YouTube, I don't know if the band has a name or not, but there's a cover band that did a recording of Secretly Cruel, but in the style of 70s Kiss, and it's perfect. It fits exactly perfect.
Hmm. That's interesting. We'll have to look that up.
Yeah.
My number 6 is I'm Alive. And I noted on here that, you know, it has a cool intro and, you know, a cool guitar riff going with it. Again, some great Bruce work on there.
Yeah.
But other than that, that's about it. I mean, it's pretty solid, and the Bruce saves Kiss on this album, I guess. Yes. For the most part, Bruce and Paul. So.
Yeah. There you go. That's given me a thought. I think it's fairly clear that, I mean, you can't really say Benny Benson saved Kiss. I think Paul saved Kiss, and I'm fairly certain we said that. But if you just have to have a lead guitarist, freaking Bruce Kulick saved Kiss.
Yeah.
You know?
And I said it when we discussed it, but I'll still say that the whole Vinnie Vincent thing, it was just brought up as a sarcastic, you know, kind of mock towards Vinnie in the first place. I don't care what they say, but
yeah,
to me that's what it came off as. And so anyway,
definitely
Vinnie's gone.
Yeah, yes. Yes. But Vinnie Vincent's Kiss is yet to emerge.
Yeah.
What was that? Somebody said not that long ago something of, I made a joke about having double V's Sweet Pain. Did you hear that? I don't remember what.
Huh.
I made some joke about that. Wait till you guys hear double V's Sweet Pain.
Oh, yeah.
Which, by the way, is what our Gene, we all have nicknames for each other that are similar to the actual Kiss name, and so we Gino and Paulie, and they call me Double V. So
they call me EC and sometimes Pete during concerts.
I just go, eh. That's what I call you. Yeah, oh man. Okay, where were we? I don't even know what's going on anymore.
You're number six.
Oh, okay. Tears Are Falling.
Wow.
Because that's what's happening here. This is one of those few songs, and I feel like it's becoming more and more that I can't keep saying few. I prefer the live version of, especially Rock the Nation. I don't know why, but I really enjoy the Rock the Nation version of this song. I don't hate the studio version at all, but it feels a little boring.
Hmm. See, that's where we're like way different, because I feel like it doesn't translate well live, and especially when we do it. That's one reason I just hate playing the song now.
I do like playing that guitar solo, though.
Yeah.
That's one of those great solos, that and I just enjoy. There's a huge stretch in there that I like doing. It's good stuff.
He likes huge stretches, people.
Yeah, huge stretch. Which, by the way, I'm going to throw this out there, too. Having said that I really like the Rock the Nation version, I feel like Tommy Thayer does not at all pull off the solo. And I'm not one of those guys that hates Tommy Thayer, so that's not a big knock on him. It's just, Bruce did it better.
What about the Vegas version? Do you like that one?
I've probably only heard that one once or twice. Okay. I have to go back and listen to it again.
Okay. Number five for me, I match Magenica and Rochelle. We had Rochelle's input this week. Rochelle being Steve's sister-in-law, correct?
Yep.
Or mother. And I seem to match Magenica a lot. I've noticed the last few, but maybe it's a drummer thing. I don't know. But, let me shut up and say my pick. It's Who Wants to Be Lonely? And this is another one that, you know, it's a good song, but it's like there's just not enough to it to really kind of make it extra special or really catchy. And the fact that they did a video for this, and again, some people say this is the best Kiss song ever, which blows my mind, but wow. it's a good song. I mean, you know, Paul's vocals on here, great. Some great vocal harmonies, and you know the rhythm of the vocals and whatnot during the verses, but it's just, I don't know, it just kind of misses a little something. And am I mistaken, but I don't think they've really ever done this one live either.
Yeah, I don't think so,
because it probably just would not translate well again. I mean,
yeah,
I'd like to hear this acoustically. I think that would make it interesting.
Definitely, I could see that.
So that was my number five. Who wants to be lonely all night?
Yeah, that's my number five. Way to go with your sixth sense there. Okay. All night.
I am the fox.
Yeah, there you go.
Whatever that means.
Right. Yeah, right. All night.
Sigh all night.
So what can be said here? Yeah, I think I almost feel like they were trying to do another Rock and Roll All Night with the anthem-iness. There's a new word for you. the anthem-iness of this song feels like it's what they were going for but didn't quite get to. But I have always liked the song. It was like I was saying earlier in the episode, after Robbie had mentioned that his Kiss fandom was pretty much over for a little while after hearing this one. But no, I agree. It is a little plain, which is why I think it didn't work the way I feel they probably intended for it to. But I've always thought the chorus was catchy. And they've never, I'll fight somebody over this, they've never written a better lyric than woo.
Wow. Not even Stand By My Side, I'll Be There For You.
No, it definitely beats that, hands down.
Oh, jeez. Oh, Lord. Number four, Secretly Cruel. I agree. This is one saving grace that Gene does have on this album, let alone, since Animalize. But yeah, it's kind of, it kind of reminds me of Killer in a way. You know, it's kind of that with the chorus and everything, and he's kind of singing it that same way with that little bit of that, little bit of that growl and, you know, the aggression in there. Definitely heads and tails above, you know, the other two abysmal songs that are on here by Gene. But, so whatever, you know, he did with Secretly Cruel, he should have kept that ball rolling. But right. It just gets worse. I'm sorry.
My number four actually is Trial by Fire. And this is a weird one that I've always liked. Again, the lyrical content is eh. I wouldn't question the message of the song, of course. Gene's big about the my life, I'm going to live it my way, which this is one of the many where he repeatedly expresses that. But yeah, an interesting concept, I guess, likening it to a trial by fire. And the chorus is catchy. I've always loved the chorus.
Absolutely. Top three. Number three, and this is surprising because I was really expecting my, you know, top three to have a different song other than this, but it's Radar for Love. And again, it all came down to doing that refresher, man. And, you know, I had in my mind, okay, these are going to be the top three songs. Let me just go through all these and make sure. Radar for Love comes on, and I'm like, man, I forgot how much I dig this song. And it's one of those, like, why isn't this on my iPod? It needs to be. Why did I leave it off? But just a great song. And coming right after Secretly Cruel, I mean, that was, you know, a pretty nice little 1-2 punch again that they threw in there. So I'll give them some credit on that. But really good track, Radar for Love. And don't confuse that with Golden Earring.
Right.
Or, who was it? Who was the band that did it in the 80s? Radar Love.
Oh. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I can't.
Yeah, I forget now. Was it White Lion?
Maybe.
Yeah, I forget, but you guys could tell us.
Yeah. Without doubt. My number three, I'm Alive. And I've noticed this one is fairly low on just about everybody else's list.
Yeah.
Jay's got it up here pretty high, looks like. But I've always really liked this one, too. Again, with the upbeat, it kind of feels like a continuation of Gimme More and maybe Under the Gun. Now, I certainly wouldn't argue that this is a better song than Under the Gun. But the upbeat Paul song with a cool chorus... always really liked. And again, man, with Eric and Bruce just blazing away through this whole song, love it.
Oh, absolutely. All right, number two. This was tough, you know, these top two, but just had to give the edge, and number two ended up going to King of the Mountain. This is such a killer tune and album opener. One of the most underrated drum intros ever. Like, you never hear anyone mention it. You know, it's kind of short and sweet, but to the point, and you know, it's just perfect Eric Carr right there. Yeah. Like, it's almost like, you know, you could listen to Car Jam and then almost throw the intro to King of the Mountain right at the end of it, and it would almost go together. Yeah. And so, you know, just a nice, you know, upbeat album opener. Again, you know, Paul kicking off the album again. Just killer over the top, you know, high vocals, and you know, just, and I love the part where you know, they get a little syncopated, man. It's like something you never really heard Kiss do before, but you know, that like, it's so cool, man. Yeah. Definitely some firsts in there. And you know, I wish they had performed it more than what they did, you know, live. I think they only really did it like for this tour, maybe. That might have been it, really, because I don't think they did it for Crazy Nights. One that I would love to see them bring back, if possible. I mean, I'm sure Eric can pull it off. You know, they do Creatures and all that stuff, and I would love to see them pull this one out. So, but this is another one that I would file in my top 20 Paul Stanley songs.
Yep. Definitely. My number two here is Who Wants to Be Lonely. And this is one that stood out to me. I don't know. I think maybe on my first ever listen through of Asylum, probably Who Wants to Be Lonely and Tears Are Falling are the ones that really stood out as like, okay, those two are probably the hits.
Yeah.
I like the guitar riff, even in the verses. The do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. That riff's always got to me. The catchy chorus. Another just great guitar solo from Bruce here. I learned it once, and I wish I still knew it, because that, again, every time I hear it, I'm like, man, that guy. And then I think forward to, I think it's Exposed, maybe. I don't know. See, I've got a DVD that combines a couple of the home videos, and it screws them all up. But it's Revenge Era, where Bruce is kind of talking about how there's all these, you know, blazing techniques that when he first joined he was doing, and then he realized he didn't need all of that crap, and now he's just going to play more for the song. And it's like, yeah, I know what you're saying, but it fits so well, and he does it so well, and he did it honestly in a way that I feel like not a whole lot of other guitar players of that era were doing. You know, I can hear a Bruce Kulick solo and know it's him. You know,
absolutely. That would have been Confidential, I believe, that video.
Gotcha.
But yeah, I mean, and again, that's one of my favorite, you know, Bruce, like, the, again, his guitar tone on, you know, Revenge, let alone Alive 3. Whew, killer. But, I totally agree with what you said. It's, you know, and, you know, it's like you were saying, that little riff during the verse, you know, it's so simple. And then the drums, too, but just the way it's going together. It's got kind of like that little chug, and like almost like a march to it in a way.
True. Yeah.
Number one, I am matching. We had, is it Rabble? It was on here.
Oh, it's Robbie.
Rob's Rabble. I swear.
The Hamburglar now?
Wow. Rabble, Rabble. Rabble, Rabble. I swore it said Rabble on the thing the way it was typed. Well, from now on, you're called Rabble, Robbie.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm matching Rabble and Rochelle. Rabshell. And Tears Are Falling. I've always dug this song. There's something about, again, this version compared to the live that just has that more of the magic to me. I mean, the way Paul does the verses, man, and you know, those weird, like the way he's singing it kind of high but soft at the same time, and yeah. I don't know, it's always caught me ever since I first heard it, and It's just, and then of course, you know, the chorus is super infectious and catchy, and you know, whenever we perform the song, we, you know, break it down to kind of a sing-along part, and you know, and it usually gets some people involved.
Yeah.
I mean, and again, it's like, I like the song so much, I wish it translated better live, or, you know, maybe we can, at least in our case, we can work on it to try to make it a little better. But as far as when Kiss does it, yeah, I mean, I agree, the Rock the Nation is cool. I mean, the Vegas one, I mean, not horrible either, but it's still just missing that. I mean, because when I'm hearing those verses, it's like, that's what I picture in my head is, you know, the way Paul sings it on the album.
Right.
So I'm interested to find out from Rabble and Rochelle what made them pick it number one as well. So.
Right.
Rabble.
Rabble. Oh, okay. So my number one here, King of the Rabble. Yeah, I mean, you pretty much touched on the whole thing. The drum intro is like, just in case you are a moron and you forgot that Eric Carr was one of the greatest drummers of the 80s,
mm-hmm.
There's your reminder. You know?
Yeah.
That just perfect, exactly perfect, and honestly a little bit surprising, because I almost feel like, you know, Paul and Gene were still kind of stifling everybody but the two of them at that point. So it's almost strange to me to think that they were like, yeah, the album can start with the drum thing. Why not? Yeah, but
it's almost like they were looking for a way to begin that song, and instead of just going where it just starts like, bam, dun, 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 Eric probably just did that out of the blue, knowing him in the studio, and they're probably like, hey, that's cool, let's start it like that.
Yeah. Yep, a perfect introduction to the album, the perfect album opener. It's got plenty of great Bruce moments, great Eric moments. Yeah, the chorus, you can't beat that chorus. That's one of my favorite parts of the songs that you brought up earlier, where they're going do 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 do. Yeah, because you don't hear that. You don't hear that in Kiss songs. They're usually just pretty straightforward.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's one of my favorite Bruce solos of all time. That right there, I get this song stuck in my head.
Yeah, it came on in the car earlier today, man, and I was blasting it. Yeah.
I'll be doing something totally different, not even Kiss related, not thinking about Kiss, not thinking about Asylum, and suddenly I'll be going, King of the Man.
King of the McGowan.
Yeah.
So, that does it. Let's see. So, Rabble and Rochelle, I want to know why you chose Tears Are Falling as number one. Do we want to maybe just kind of quickly go through and mention what everyone else's number one is, just for the heck of it? Or
yeah, might as well. Let me see. I was tallying here.
I mean, even though people see it, let's just mention them, I guess, for that matter.
So my dad, his number one was All Night. Steve, King of the Mountain. My younger brother, Sam, also King of the Mountain. My fiance, Savannah's number one was Who Wants to Be Lonely. Younger sister, Magenica's King of the Mountain. Rabble. Tears Are Falling.
Does it not look like it says Rabble on that?
No, I totally see that. Now that as soon as you said it, and you said it looked like that, the first thing I did was scrolled over and clicked on it to make sure I hadn't typed it that way. Definitely says Robbie, but no,
I was thinking, oh, it's some new guy that commented or something, you know, Rabble.
Yes. Jay Rucker's number one, All Night. Jay's dad, King of the Mountain. Let me really quick scroll back over. His niece put in, I think, maybe her top three or something, and I only put her overall vote in because, like I said, the partial lists don't fit the system very well. But let me scroll over because I'm sure that was one she put in there.
In case anyone's wondering why Luke's dad chose All Night as number one, it's because that's the song that Luke was conceived to.
Oh, God! And now I know. All right.
with the video playing in the background.
Interestingly, Jay's niece, look, I'm Alive, is the number one.
Wow, cool.
So good to go there. I agree. Always like that one. Yeah, I can't get over it now. That's what I thought. You broke my whole day.
Oh, God.
Rapshell McGowan, number one, Tears Are Falling. Jason Vanover, and man, I hope I've got your last name right there. Like I repeatedly say, I'm horrible with that. Who Wants to Be Lonely in the number one spot again?
Wow.
Yeah, so I think that's everybody. Let me jump through and get tallied here. Looks like our top three are good to go. We did end up with a couple of ties, though.
All right. Well, as far as overall ranking, I'm gonna give this one a 5. Again, it's blaming it on Gene. Those weak-ass songs that he has just bring it down that much. I mean, and again, there are some obviously killer Paul stuff on here, as we were just talking about, and you know, between Eric and Bruce as well, but man, it's those Gene songs that bring it down to that notch.
Yeah. And I struggled with this for a long time. This was one of the main ones that I listened to when I went through that period that I talk about fairly often of basically only listening to the non-makeup albums. This was usually the one that I put in. It was definitely one of my favorites. It didn't hit me quite the way it used to on today's listen through. Not that I disliked any of it. I still ended up giving this one an 8 out of 10, and I think it's because of that. This one has a high nostalgia factor for me because of that. I knew this was one of my favorite ones, and honestly, I think it's because of Bruce. To me, this is Bruce's album, which is weird since it's his first with them, but everything he does on this album is just spot on, perfect for what they were doing. He pulled the stuff off live extremely well, you know. And I've never really thought about it until we started doing Sweet Pain, but even the way that I play guitar is fairly similar to Bruce. I have less problems emulating Bruce solos than any other guitar player when we play those songs.
I noticed that.
I wonder now if it's because this album was almost always my go-to. You know, I had him in my ear all the time. So
yeah, right. You know, and all through the years, you know, next to Ace, Bruce was always my second favorite Kiss guitarist. So, you know, and again, I'm not taking anything away from Vinny or Mark, but Bruce definitely fit, you know, right just the way Ace did. He fit in so perfect. And, yeah, he should have been the guy before they decided to go with Vinny, because that's how long Bob was trying to, you know, vouch for him, and they finally listened.
Yep.
And they probably did wish, man, why didn't we decide to give him a chance earlier? But, hey. But thankfully, he had a pretty long career with them. Unfortunately, you know, not as long now as Tommy's been in the band. But hey, he's still, you know, he's playing with Grand Funk to this day. And, you know, he's at almost all the expos every year. He's a super cool guy to talk to. Still putting out great music. You know, his recent solo album that came out a few years ago is absolutely great. I love the song he does on there with Nick Simmons. I mean, Nick Simmons' voice is just amazing on there. Yeah. Very good song. So,
but I don't think that those were on Jay's list. That's Bruce Kulick's solo albums are another one that we need to do.
Yes, like, my God, there's what, that Union, and you know, then the ESP stuff, and you can even go back as far as the first band that Bruce is in called Blackjack with Michael Bolton.
Oh, wow. Wow. Yeah. All right. Well, I do believe that we have got our rankings here.
All right.
All right, so like I said, there's two ties here, but both are fairly low on the list, so it's nothing that we need to worry about with a tiebreaker. So our last place in this video is number eighth place, Love's a Deadly Weapon. So, big surprise, it was a Gene song. tied here in seventh place, bet you can't guess. Any way you slice it. and somewhat surprisingly, Radar for Love.
Huh? Yeah. So surprised I dropped my pen.
Yeah. Didn't throw a notebook, though, so. tied for sixth place, Secretly Cruel and I'm Alive.
I'm saving the notebook throw for next time Steve's on, saying this is his least favorite Kiss album.
Yeah, well, man, Steve, jeez. All right. Fifth place, Trial by Fire. And I'll admit, I did not expect that one to rank high. I mean, it ranks high for me, but I didn't expect it to rank that high overall.
Yeah, absolutely.
In fourth place, Sorry Rabble, All Night. And finally, our top three for this video, fairly easy to guess, I would say. In third place, Who Wants to Be Lonely? In second place, Tears Are Fallen. And our first place for Asylum, King of the Mountain. So, another Paul album, hands down.
King of the McGowan.
King of the McGowan, yes.
I could dig it. You know, now I wish Secretly Cruel was ranked higher.
Yeah, honestly, yeah. Of all the Gene songs, that one definitely deserves something.
Because the more I think about it, the more I'm like, how much I really do like that song.
All right, and we ended up with an overall ranking average of 7 out of 10, which is saying something. I think that came from what I said earlier of this being a very mixed bag.
Yeah.
As far as opinions, considering Steve gave this the second lowest rating of any rating we've given any album so far in the countdown, for it to still get a 7 out of 10 is pretty crazy. So yes. There's definitely some fairly warranted hatred of this album, and also some definitely warranted love for this album.
Yeah, and again, I was guilty of this year for years. You know, I it was the whole book by its cover thing. You know, and other than those three, you know, music videos, those were the only songs I listened to for the longest time. And you know, one day I decided, well, you know, over a matter of a few days, I decided to sit down and listen to every Kiss record, you know, beginning to end, and a lot of that non-makeup stuff. It was like a first because so many of those albums I never listened to the whole thing. It was just certain songs.
Right.
And then when I got through that one, I'm like, oh my God, like there was some really cool, like heavy stuff on there for, you know, for its time. And
yeah,
it really made me appreciate it so much more.
Definitely. Definitely. An important album. Definitely.
It sure is. So it's, wow, it's coming up on, what, 30 years itself.
Yeah.
Jeez.
That's nuts.
So thank you all, as always, except for Steve, for your input. And oh, yeah, I'm surprised it still got a 7 based on some of those rankings. And so what is it? Is Crazy Nights next, or is it Smashes first?
Crazy Nights first, and then Smashes.
That's what I thought. I just wanted to make sure. So you're going to hear plenty of hatred for Smashes. But Crazy Nights, you might be surprised, because this time with the Gene stuff, there's a lot of Gene stuff on there I really do like.
For sure. I've always kind of felt, completely honestly, that Good Girl Gone Bad is a strangely good song for an era where Gene wasn't trying very hard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. So, so real quick with the game board here, definitely take a look at that, everybody, because there's a lot of different stuff on there. Notably, we've got Peter got another medal here, third place for with Strange Ways on Hotter Than Hell.
Oh, yeah.
So that's pretty cool. At the moment, other than the solo albums, of course, Hotter Than Hell is now the only album that Paul has no medals. It edged Hotter Than Hell, the title track, out.
Wow.
So, yeah. Definitely interesting there. Let me think. There was a couple of other things that I thought was interesting. Oh, yes, Dynasty. Hard Times creeping up into third place, so that's neat. Ace getting another medal there, somewhat unexpected. Mr. Blackwell also creeping up into third place for The Elder. Although, while we're on the subject of The Elder, I have to say, because of the extra ratings, and mostly because of Jay's dad, that now has by far the lowest average overall rating of all, with a 4.8 out of 10.
Wow.
And if you've started a Justice for Fits Like a Glove movement, I want to start a Justice for the Overall Ranking of Music from The Elder, because I personally do not feel it deserves that. Come on. Peter Criss's solo album has a 6.4. Is The Elder a worse album than Peter Criss? No. Come on! There's no way. There's no way. Hey. I genuinely be angry if that ends up the lowest ranked album of all of them.
Even Ace Frehley himself said just recently that Elder is not a bad album. It was just at the wrong time. He wanted it to be like what Creatures ended up being, is what he felt they should have been writing, not Elder. I mean,
agree. That's sound logic.
Yeah. So it's not that he hates the album, like, you know, a lot of the stories went. It just wasn't. And maybe, yeah, maybe he hated it at the time. But at today, he, you know, it's not a bad album, is what he says. And it just was the wrong timing.
Indeed. But I think that it struck me really hard doing all those rankings, and especially seeing The Elder getting such a low ranking. It's so strange. Because so many of you are giving us input, and it's awesome to see that, to see all these differing opinions creating kind of a collective. Because when we started this, I never would have thought that something so opposite of my own opinion would end up being in what's virtually the finished product. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm not mad about it. I've made it clear with everybody's opinions. But
People, he cries off camera, so.
I do. He has to go in and CGI edit out my tears.
You can see him falling.
Yes.
He wipes his eyes like this.
Yeah. So I don't know. I don't know what else could be rated lower than that, but I hope The Elder doesn't end up being the lowest rating.
Smashes, Threshes, and Hits.
It could. It very well could be, yeah. So let's get in there. Everybody, create a bunch of extra accounts to go in and bring that rating up. No, yeah. Don't do that. Don't cheat. But no. Bring the rating up.
But all you people that are, you know, participating, spread the word. All your fellow KISS friends, family, like some of you are already doing,
yes.
Have them give input. I mean, who knows? A month, 6 months from now, we may suddenly get all kinds of different votes for The Elder on top of everything, and it may bring it back up to the middle of the list or something. Who knows, you know?
Right. No, absolutely. Yep. So, Creature's still bringing up the lead. 9.8 out of 10. I don't think anything's going to beat it.
I really don't at this point.
We got a couple that are somewhat up there. Looks like the closest at the moment is Alive 1 with a 9.5, which... That's fair. That's warranted. Love Gun with a 9. Also Ace with a 9. So yeah, that makes a lot of sense. But yeah, I'm fairly certain Creatures is...
I was going to say, for me, the only things that would come anywhere close would probably be Revenge and Alive 3. Other than that, I don't think anything else in my votes are going to be anywhere near that.
I don't know. I feel like everybody is going to give Sonic Boom Disc 2 a 10 out of 10.
So all right.
Step back, I forgot. Yes, Smashes and Sonic Boom Disc 2 may come under 4.8.
Let's sure hope.
Yeah.
Steve will probably say it's his favorite or something. Well, we highly appreciate, again, all the input you guys are giving us, and just keep the ball rolling, and we want more and more to pop up. Again, you know, you would have seen the images of the picks and the game board, but we're going to start posting them on the Facebook page now as well, so you guys can really get a good look at them now if you want to. And, again, keep spreading the word, get more people involved. You know, keep getting people to subscribe to our channel. I think we're almost at 230 now, I believe, last I looked. And really cool. So, and again, don't forget, go out and get your copy of Spaceman if you haven't. Local FYE has it on sale for $24.99 vinyl, and I believe $9.99 for the CD. So, no, we were not paid to advertise that, but just saying, good deals out there. So,
both Ace and Best Buy owe us money now.
All right, so next week, Crazy Nights on the Crazy Crazy Kiss Countdown. So, it's going to be a lot of craziness involved with and saying the word crazy a lot, and tears falling and all night. Are we due to have any guests yet, or is everyone holding out till like Revenge?
That's the next one that I know about.
So everyone's holding out.
Exactly. Let's get Javier in here.
Which not one touching that with a 10-foot pole.
Yeah.
We'll do Revenge.
Yeah. On makeup era, let's not do any of this.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but if anyone's a fan of Crazy Nights, which I know there's plenty out there, hey, come on the show with us next week. Get a hold of us. So, if not, me and Luke will see you next week, and keep those votes coming in. So, until next week, everyone take care, and go get your Ace fix with Spaceman. Bye. Burn, bitch, burn.
Not again.
Standing out here yelling rabble, rabble, rabble isn't going to help anything.